It is sometimes difficult to detect an orogenic blocking during the recording. Visual inspection of traces after the recording may be necessary. This will show such an example. This recording contains 4 time-locked potentials. There is also activity from other motor unit potentials with similar amplitude, and hence we will use the peak trigger to record the signals. Observe the jitter and blocking. All traces are shown in superimposed mode. The first potential was used for triggering and shows excellent superimposition. It confirms that we have triggered the sweeps from a single motor unit. Any blocking in this recording is not due to technical problems. The second and third potentials cannot be seen clearly. There is a wide area where these potentials occur on the sweep and indicate increased jitter. We cannot say if there is blocking. Potential 4 also shows high jitter. However, the interpotential interval with respect to the first potential is more than 6 milliseconds. We cannot see blocking in this display. There are also potentials from other active motor units seen along the baseline, but they are not time locked. Let us look at these traces by reviewing 10 sweeps at a time. On the top 2 traces, potentials 2 and 3 are seen distinctly and separated from each other. On the third trace, the spikes interfere to become a signal similar to a single fiber spike. On the fifth trace, the second potential is missing. This demonstrates increased jitter and blocking. A similar pattern is seen on the remaining 5 traces. Because of superimposition of potentials, we can't measure the jitter for either of these 2 potentials. Nevertheless, we know that we have abnormal neuromuscular transmission in one end plate. Potential 4 appears to have normal jitter in these 10 sweeps. But in another portion of the recording, it is blocked on 2 discharges. It is interesting to note that whenever potential 4 blocks, the third potential is also blocked. On the second trace from bottom, potentials 3 and 4 both appear to shift right together. In another section of the recording, potentials 3 and 4 are blocked on the bottom trace. On the top 2 traces, they appear to shift right together. Here are another 10 discharges. On the top and bottom traces, potentials 3 and 4 shift right together. The concomitant shift of potential and blocking are consistent with the neurogenic blocking. The blocking in potential 2 could also be due to lesion in an axon, but we can't differentiate axonal blocking from end plate blocking from discharges of a single fiber potential with blocking. In this display, by chance, on trace 1, spikes 2, 3, and 4 block together. This recording was made in a patient with neuropathy. For further reading, see chapter 6 in the single fiber book, pages 46 through 86.